Nigeria's public debt has been on the rise as successive governments have continued on a borrowing spree, with the federal government's component of the public debt surging 6.58% to 26.9 trillion naira in the last 21 years, raising concerns amongst Nigerians on the debt sustainability of the country amid dwindling revenue to meet the debt obligations to creditors. As of March 2021, Nigeria's total debt had hit 33.1 trillion naira, that's about $87.24 billion, which is an accumulation of borrowings from successive governments, of which most were borrowed since the return to democratic rule in 1999. The huge dependence on proceeds from crude oil, leaving other revenue sources unexplored, indicates that Nigeria is not set to rein in debt accumulation and in the short to medium term, as public debt stock continued to trend upwards with a jump from 7.6 trillion naira, that's $48.7 billion in 2012, to $32.9 trillion, $32.9 trillion naira, that's $86.8 billion in 2020. Meanwhile, in recent times, external borrowing started gaining momentum as it surged from 1 trillion naira, 14% of total debt in 2012, to 12.7 trillion naira, 39% of total debt in 2020. Similarly, total debt service to revenue ratio jumped from 12.3% in 2012 to 40.3% in 2020. Despite the negative toll of the debt profile Nigeria is having on the economy, the Debt Management Office has insisted that the nation's debt is still sustainable and is yet to reach the threshold set by an International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. Well, to discuss this more and, of course, other issues affecting the Nigerian economy, first, let me introduce him as a fiscal policy partner and Africa Tax Leader at PwC. He is also the chairman, Debt Management Roundtable and Nigerian Economic Summit Group. It's Mr. Taiwo Oyedele. Good afternoon. It's good to see you, Mr. Oyedele.
Good afternoon. Always nice to be here.
Yes. When I was reading through this, Nigeria's debt ratio, I think debt to GDP ratio, is still far below 70%. So, I don't know. Why should we be worried about public debt at this time?
Yeah, I think first and foremost, we need to understand the distinction between public debt owned by a country versus individuals and households. So people tend to react like, you know the way they say it in Nigeria, they say onigbese. Onigbese is meant to give you the connotation of someone who is flamboyant, extravagant, and they're not prudent. But when it comes to countries, it's a completely different ball game. So as we speak today, America has the largest absolute amount of debt in the world. Yes. So America's debt is more than Africa's GDP multiplied by five. It's almost $19 trillion. And nobody worries about whether America can sustain it. So really, countries, in principle, don't have to pay back their debts. You can keep refinancing it. So when this one is due for payment, borrow another one and use it to pay. You can do that forever. So therefore, what's really important is the cost of servicing the debt. Or put differently, we can say the terms of borrowing, right? So when America borrows, or the likes of Japan or UK, they borrow at next to nothing. In fact, countries like Japan borrow at negative interest rates. So in other words, you give me your money, I keep for you. And at periodic intervals, every 6 months, for example, I'll take part of your money that I'll never return back to you. And people still do that. Unfortunately, in Africa, particularly so in Nigeria, whenever we borrow at high rates, sometimes in double digits.
Yeah.
So if you now borrow, for example, in dollars or euro bond, and you're paying 9% at the time when Naira was 165, and Naira is now about 410, depending on the market you go, it can easily be over 500. You may easily be paying back interest at very high rates, effectively about 20, 30, 40, even 50%. So if you continue like that, I think from my point of view, the number one predictor of your ability to sustain your debt is your debt service costs as a ratio of your revenue. So Nigeria is somewhere around 70%. So we're spending far too much out of our small and lean revenue in servicing debt. So if we don't reverse that trend, then our debt becomes unsustainable, even though the debt to GDP ratio is still very low.
So in the near future, is it looking like it could get unsustainable, just like they say subsidy is not sustainable?
Yeah, of course, that near future is not far from where we are. The only hope is that we have a turnaround in terms of our revenue generation. There's really not so much we can do, even though there are a few things we can do in terms of reducing the need for borrowing. I think Nigerians don't properly interpret it when government says we have a budget and the budget deficit is 5 trillion. Nigerians don't understand what it means.
True.
When government now start borrowing, then they start complaining. But actually what government was saying to you is, I have to spend 13 trillion, but I'm only expecting 8 trillion. So I'm going to borrow 5 trillion. Everybody clapped. Nobody complained, right? So, but what government can also do is, one, you can look at expenditure efficiency. Can you rationalize some of this spending? Are they really necessary? We still have issues of budget padding. Number two is to try and see how you can be more creative in ensuring that private sector is driving a lot of expenditure, especially in the area of infrastructure, whether it's rail, power generation, refining. Private sector will do those things far better than public sector can ever do. We did need to borrow $1.5 billion to do turnaround. Private sector will do that easily. So if you push away those kind of costs and you try to get, you know, some of the excess costs of governance in Nigeria, you bring it down as well, you easily find that you free up a lot of space so that your borrowing will have to be a lot less than it is. And then on the other side, do everything to then raise your revenue profile, and then Nigeria will be fine.
Let's now identify some of the drivers of this rising public debt. It's focused on Nigeria.
Yeah, COVID hasn't helped. Number one factor would easily be COVID, because in absolute terms, our budget deficit is the largest in our history for this year. So we're hoping it to go down a little bit by next year, based on the presentation on MTEF by the Honorable Minister for Finance, Budget and National Planning. So COVID is one. Number two is our population is growing so fast. And of course, the more people you have, the more the demand on infrastructure, social services, and also, you know, the fact that we don't have infrastructure and government is trying to fill in the gap. So that is driving expenditure. We're seeing the public sector, unfortunately, continues to balloon, even though you can see a lot of productivity. But every year, one year to the other, the recurrent expenditure is increasing. And that is one area where if we budget 5 trillion, we'll spend it. Our performance on recurrent expenditure is always 100%. Sometimes we overperform, self.
When it comes to recurrent, but capital
is where we struggle, So those are driving it. And then the biggest one actually that is driving this is, unfortunately, debt itself. So our debt, the cost of servicing our debt, is the fastest growing public expenditure that we have in Nigeria today. It's growing so fast and it's scary. So those combined, servicing our debt, recurrent expenditure, capital expenditure combined are the reason why we're having to borrow and borrow and do more borrowings.
And we still keep borrowing. Now, let's not talk about strategies, because when we talk about identify the problem and really get details of this, what strategies can be deployed? Many times we talk about long term, because it's just something that can just happen overnight. So short, medium, long term, what can be done to help us achieve debt sustainability in Africa's most populous nation?
Yeah, I like that question. I think the first thing is, first and foremost, let's know the size of the problem we're dealing with. I don't think that we know in Nigeria. And I say that because, for example, ways and means financing, that's CBN just literally printing money for us to spend. It's over 13 trillion, and it's not included in this number that you read earlier on. So it's not included in our debt profile. We have government agencies that also have indebtedness. They're also not included. We have obligations and commitments and guarantees, call them contingent liabilities. They're also not included. So number one thing we should do in the short term is to do a complete assessment, evaluation, to determine exactly the level of our indebtedness. Once you've done that, the second thing you need to do is take a second look at your budget. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, you know, a few years back, the president said zero-based budgeting. Many of us were very excited. We did it 1 year. In fact, we did it for half a year because that year we did it, it wasn't really zero-based. Mm-hmm. If you go back to zero-based budgeting, you interrogate every single expense line. Don't start paying rent for Aso Rock, right? Don't start doing this ridiculous thing. If you read what budget does, for example, you go through the expense line and you just worry.
Yes. Yes.
If you can try and do a cleanup so that every naira we spend is money that we must spend and then we get value for it. And then the third one, so this is the one that has to be medium to long term, is really how do you raise revenue? Yeah. And I think the biggest way to do that is to try and use data, technology, and intelligence. Clearly, I just know that Nigerians, you know, the wrong people in Nigeria are the one paying the taxes. And they are the bottom of the ladder because we do PAYE from their stipends that they collect on a monthly basis. The middle class and the upper class and politicians and wealthy people, including traders who make a lot of money, are not paying taxes. And it's easy for me to reach this conclusion because the personal income tax in Nigeria of all the state plus FCT plus everybody is under 1 trillion naira. South Africa, you know, I always like to play around with this data, collects over 12 trillion naira equivalent from personal income tax alone after exempting all their poor people from tax. The same thing with VAT. So there was this judgment that people are debating.
Yes, I wanted to go there. I was saying I was going to go there.
Yes.
Is that a win for FRS with all of the projections that we've had before now? Everybody is hoping that, yes, we'll get more money from taxation. And now, if we go by the Rivers State judgment, what would happen, except for states like maybe Lagos, a few states, maybe two, three, four states, what would happen? Would that not affect projections already made by FRS?
Interestingly, you know that FRS... maybe not FRA, let me say the federal government.
Yes.
The federal government will benefit. The federal government will be a net beneficiary of that judgment. All the other states, apart from Lagos State, will be the net losers. and overall, Nigeria will be a net loser if you implement that judgment. And I'll tell you why. So as of last year, the total collection from VAT was about 1.53 trillion naira. Out of that amount, about 51% represented VAT on imports and VAT on foreign services, all these international transactions. So, you know, even if you enforce this law today that says states should be the one collecting VAT in their jurisdiction, states cannot go and collect at the border. They cannot collect on international services. So, which means federal governments, whether they're using customs or FRS, we collect the international one. And it's about 50%. Is far more than what federal government is sharing today. In fact, the VAT on federal government contract, which is huge, would also go to federal government. So states will now have the lower end of the stick that they have to share. Plus, they don't have the capacity to collect. They have been collecting personal income tax for over 40 years. There's no progress. So I'm not very optimistic that this is a good thing. From a fiscal federalism point of view, maybe we need to then take a second look at our constitution and see how can we devise a structure and a format of consumption tax that fits our situation and that complies with the constitution? That would be my take on that.
So now let's now look at specific alternatives for Nigeria to get to the path of debt sustainability. I think this will be deliberate efforts that we need to make. Or what are the specific or alternatives that can help this country?
No, I think this, you know, the biggest solution to solving debt crisis or problem is to grow the economy, right? So if your economy is growing, right, and growing faster than your borrowing, your debt to GDP ratio will be decent. Your revenue collection will be high enough that whatever you are paying as debt service costs will not be material to put a dent. But that's easier said than done. You know, it's not easy to develop the economy. Yeah. So which means in the short, medium and long term, we have to have a mix or a blended strategy of both addressing the expenditure side And those expenditure side, you have to break into the three components of debt service, recurrent, and capital. So I can easily say to you today, government can move almost 90% of the capital expenditure to the private sector. Mm-hmm. Even the new tolling that they said they're going to introduce, right? Mm-hmm. Tolling of highway simply means that those highways are commercially viable. Give it to the private sector, they will build it, collect their money from tolling for another 30 years, transfer it back to government. You don't have to borrow to do it. Rail, private sector will do it. Electricity, they will do it. Refining. So that's one big aspect that we can take advantage of. Again, we can't but go back to our recurrent to try and clean out, you know, some of the padding and the inefficiency there, as well as relook at our, you know, our debt structure. Can we renegotiate some of the terms? Can we, in some cases, where we are owing the likes of IDA and the IMF, can we beg for forgiveness, even though I think we cannot be going back every time to be begging, you know? So if you combine these strategies and then going forward, ensure that you put your best foot forward in negotiating these terms so that you get the best deal. And also ensure that, you know, even in terms of what you use the money for, you prioritize projects that are self-financing so that those projects pay back the interest, rather than government having to budget from its lean revenue to be able to pay those debt service costs.
I'm really very interested in what DMR is all about. And I want to ask Director, what value proposition is DMR, of DMR is distinct from related interventions, of course, with regards to debt management? What message are you really passing? What do you intend to achieve?
Yeah, great question. So the Debt Management Roundtable is the initiative of the Nigeria Economy Summit Group. With support from OSIWA. So what we're trying to do is we're focusing on West Africa, but really the story across Africa is not very different. Based on the information released by the World Bank regarding the International Development Association lending, of the top 10 countries in the world, about 74 developing countries that they support, the top 10 out of those 74 countries, six of them are in Africa, led by Nigeria. You know, you have other countries, including Ghana, including Kenya, Ethiopia, you know, Uganda, and they're having these issues around debt.
Yes.
So what we are trying to do at the Debt Management Roundtable is, first and foremost, let's understand our context. So just using these IMF benchmark, for example, sometimes send the wrong signal to our leaders.
Yes.
They think, we can keep borrowing because IMF says 70%.
Yeah.
But 70%, it's not sustainable anymore. Whereas Japan is at over 200% and nobody worries about sustainability. Mm-hmm. So can we have our own local context? And then number two, can we try and come up with insights to help policymakers and governments in Africa using Nigeria as a case study as to how do we address issues of measurement, the terms, the utilization, the efficiency, the reporting, transparency around it, the term. So there's a lot of issues, including how do you renegotiate the terms. So for us, we're not criticizing and blaming anyone because that never solves any problems. What we want to do is to bring insights. We have experts from different countries, and I have the privilege of being asked to share the debt management roundtable. Very exciting for me. So we're currently doing all our analysis with a lot of research going on. At some point, we then share our thoughts with both the public, the private sector, but more importantly, those policymakers, so they can begin to take actions. For us, it's a call to action to do something differently so we can reverse this very worrying and concerning trend.
Well, it's always a pleasure having you in the studio. Someone sent me a message yesterday when I did this flyer. I said the soft-spoken Mr. Taiwo Oyedele. Thank you for your time.
Thank you,
fiscal policy partner, Africa Tax Leader, PwC, and also the chairman, Debt Management Roundtable of the Nigerian Economic Summit Group. Thank you very much for spending your time with us this afternoon.
It's
we appreciate
pleasure.
This.